thrilled to be able to work with these fine individuals.
And welcome aboard. We some of you are returning, some of you are new. We appreciate your willingness to serve the city of Houston. And Phyllis, it's good to see you.
Thank you, Mayor. First, congratulations on some fine appointments. I see a lot of friendly faces, but I want to say to Phyllis, who would have ever thought? I mean, the mayor's here, I'm here, be a judge. We spent many years ago in the rooms advocating for people's rights and for justice, and in a very different venue. But here we are, just continuing on that journey. And I want to say just how proud I am of your appointment. I know what a fine judge you're going to be. Your sense of justice is right on, and I'm just so proud to see you, and hope I can come over and watch you on the bench. I'm sure it'll be quite an experience, so congratulations.
I want to congratulate you all. I'm certain you all are as dedicated as Phyllis Randolph Frye, whom everyone knows.
Councilman Bradford.
Thank you, Mayor. I want to commend Mayor Parker and Judge Harbaugh. I like what I see. I know there are a few people who are being confirmed as one of them not here, but I like the representation. You really do represent Houston, Harrison, Texas, and that's really great. Congratulations to each one of you. A special congrats to Dana, University of Houston Law School, really has treated us well. And Phyllis, thank you. Thank you for your many, many years of service in the community. I think that many of the issues coming before the court will deal with public safety personnel, particularly police officers. You've had years of experience on both sides of the aisle fighting for justice, and I've always found you to be a temperament, fair, and just this is well suited for you. Thank you very much to all of you. God speak with you.
Again, thank you.
The Honorable Judge Phyllis Randolph Frye.
You probably know, but if you don't, on Wednesday, Mayor Parker officially nominated myself and my good friend Ken Spain, and the City Council unanimously confirmed, and both Ken and I were sworn in as associate judges for our City of Houston Municipal Courts. I want to take a few minutes to let you know what that is and what that isn't. It is not a full-time judgeship. It's an assistant or it's an associate judgeship, but it's a part-time job. I am still going to be keeping my day job. The six attorneys of Frye and Associates are still going to be fighting for the LGBT and straight alliance community. I will still be taking you, if you want me to, through the courts to get your name and gender ID stuff done. This is a part-time job, but I also am becoming more and more aware of what a really big deal this is. I sensed that it was going to be a big deal because when I knew it was actually going to happen, I told about two dozen people that I knew in various parts of my life, to include the League of Women Voters, some of the people with them, to include some of the neighborhood association of which I'm an officer, to let some of the leaders of the community know, and a few other people. And I said, keep this close to your vest, because I just feel in my bones that if it gets out, that someone will strong arm somebody on city council, and when it comes up, they will tag it, which is a 2-week delay, and it'll just become a mess. And so I knew that it might be a big deal. I just wasn't prepared for how big a deal it has become. Nationally, everything is exploding right now. There is a very fine lawyer and a good friend of mine named Victoria Kolakowski, who ran for election and won as a judge in California. And she's going to be sworn in January. But I beat her sworn in Wednesday. And my law partner, Sal, said, I turn on the radio and I go to some LGBT satellite station, and there you are. And I go to these LGBT blogs around the country, and there you are. I understand I'm on HRC Facebook. I understand that I'm on a whole bunch of things. CNN has called, but I've declined. It's just surreal. So you're going to have to kind of let me get used to this. Because I realize more and more, even though I have been a very out front leader of this community for a long time, this is different. This is really different, and I'm very excited about it. And I hope that I serve you in many ways well. But of course, we're here to remember the ugly face. We're here to discuss the bigotry. We are here today to remember. And you know, it didn't even take 12 hours before the uglies were out. I was really surprised. There was a reporter from Channel 2 that was there at City Council, and Chris Banks assured me she was a very nice person. And I interviewed with her, and Channel 2 ran a real nice deal on me. I saw it the next morning on the internet. Channel 26 called, and I used to trust Channel 26, but since I've heard that it is now becoming really a Fox, I didn't, and so I didn't. And I saw the next morning, and they just ate me up. And they let this bigot, who was the same one who got about two sentences in the wonderful Houston Chronicle article, they let him have his time to go at me. And I thought, I've never met this man. He doesn't know me. He doesn't know us. And he is so insecure that he is worried about someone who's been a lawyer for almost 30 years, who has tried first, second, third degree felony cases, who has won some of those felony cases, who has made friends all over the state with judges and members of the state bar, and he doesn't think I'm qualified to part-time sit on a bench dealing with traffic tickets and public intoxication. How insecure can he be? Just insecure enough to instigate somebody to get wild enough to go out and kill one of us. That's how. And he was also going on about Mayor Parker pushing her agenda. Well, you know, if Mayor Parker had been a white Christian male and had appointed another white Christian male, would Mayor Parker then be pushing his white Christian male agenda? I'm always amazed how the people in the majority, in the demographic majority, feel so entitled that when someone from a demographic minority actually achieves something, that they say it's special, that it's, we don't deserve it. Well, when you leave here, you know that you deserve it. And the next time you hear somebody talk about special rights, you challenge them. You have to challenge them. I've gone over all my time, but I thought that this was an unusual circumstance for me and for you. So I wanted to say what I've said. I am just so honored to be called judge by you, and I know that y'all are all getting a big tickle out of it, and that's fine, because you've never had that before. So go for it. I'll get used to it, and we'll look forward to Victoria getting sworn in, and for others to make the same jump. Thank you.
As soon as I stepped in the DA's office dressed as Phyllis, I was going to be arrested. And so that's what was going on. It was fixing to get real nasty real fast.
We all lived in very tangible fear that we may have to go to jail. And if you're afraid of going to jail, you're already under control.
She does not want to be in the camera. I'm the public person, she's the private person, but everything that I went through back then, she was right there beside me. The loss of my job, the loss of our income, the threat of me being arrested on a daily basis as I went about lobbying to get rid of this ordinance. Every day that she left to go to work, she didn't know if when she came home if I was going to be in jail or not. And I know it was a terrifying experience for her. I also know that during all this time, when I was in law school and still trying to get rid of the ordinance, that one night some people, some very ugly people from the Young Americans for Freedom at the University of Houston campus came to our house, and I wasn't there, and they started banging on the windows and threatening to sexually assault her and just scared the living fool out of her. John Gudner, District F, had a craw full of Phyllis Frye walking by once a week. And so during the city council pop-off session, which is when they say whatever they want to, he said something really ugly about me and transgender people in general. I didn't hear it, but I found out about it. And I was, you know, I was there in the council offices, and I just lost it. I just started crying. And Ray told Trish and me one night when he was over for supper and we were visiting, he said, I heard the funniest story from the Vice Squad. And this was when I was lobbying like crazy to get rid of this one. And he said, what's that? And he said, well, these two Vice Squad officers that I know, they came up to me and they said, where is this Phyllis Frye person? And Ray said, what do you mean? And he says, we are out in mats every night to every bar in Houston looking for Phyllis Frye so we can arrest her. And he said, she's at home at night with her wife. She's probably watching television. She's probably in bed asleep by 9:30. And they couldn't have